and I can answer that. So a quick introduction to my lab. So one thing we do is we join transcriptomic data sets, and we use these data sets to understand disorders of the brain, so neuropsychiatric disorders. And so we build computational tools to do this, and we also do this ourselves on specific disorders. And one thing we do, we try to cross many data sets and also cross species and different types of data to gain confidence in our results, which you'll see some of that here. One example of this work is an anorexia nervosa study, so I'm just going to quickly go over this. But one thing at the top, we take genes associated with the disorder, and these are genes that are not tied to any specific tissue or part of the brain, so genetic findings. And then what we do is sort of project them onto transcriptomic resources. So these are atlases of the brain that measure gene expression across the brain or in certain types of cells. And also we look in studies that say study food deprivation. And then the idea is this is black and white. We can add some color to these in terms of, say, are these genes underexpressed or overexpressed? And that's sort of the red and blue there. So that's a type of thing that we do. And it's a sort of contextualization or characterization of genes. So it's like doing gene ontology enrichment analysis, but instead of using the gene ontology, you're using other data sets that cross, say, development or cell type or species or neuroanatomy. And so we focus on gene expression in the brain. So most genes are expressed in the brain at some time or some place in the brain. And the differences between different parts of the brain are kind of huge. There's a lot of genes changing expression patterns. So there's a huge amount of heterogeneity there. And also, it changes across time points and cells and parts of the brain. So, we use a lot of brain atlases. So the Allen Institute for Brain Science is one of the biggest providers of these atlases. And we use their data. And what's nice is they're comprehensive in two ways. So comprehensive in terms of getting all the parts of the brain and comprehensive in getting the whole genome. So they use microarrays or RNA sequencing to get all the genes there. So. And then, they use a bunch of methods, so microarray, RNA sequencing, and single-cell sequencing as well. So you'll see all of those actually in this talk. So mostly, with this type of analysis, you can do pretty simple things. Just say, is this gene expressed here? And you can sort of let the data do the work. But we also do more complex analysis using more complex techniques, which I won't go over so much today. But one example is this project where we're using images of the mouse brain. So each one of these images are stained for a specific gene to get the spatial pattern, and those are images, and then we can do things like get an embedding of that gene expression information to do better, to do easier computation with. So I'm not going to go over that too much, but that's just an idea for what our lab does. And so I'm going to talk a lot about the Allen Human Brain Atlas. So this is an atlas of six as normal as best they can brains, postmortem brains, and once they get these brains, they basically dissect them. And so for this atlas, they were able to get six individuals, six brains. And what they did is basically they did a massive amount of gene expression profiling on these brains to make this atlas. So 3,700 samples over these six brains. So this is from the Allen Institute for Brain Science. And here's one of their figures. So it's a huge project. I'm not involved with it directly, but I'm happy that they're very open about their data and they believe in open science, which is great. And so basically you can sort of look at the top corner. So in the top corner way up there is the specimen acquisition. So that's the postmortem brain. And then basically it goes through many steps of dissection. And there's different levels. There's macro dissection where you use a scalpel and you sort of dissect out the larger parts of the brain. And there's also laser micro dissection, so that's like way down in this corner here. You can see this is hippocampus, and this is before and kind of after. So all those little squares are little dissections that they use a laser to draw an outline, and then that piece of tissue falls out, and you do gene expression profiling of that very fine dissection. And basically, they do a lot of informatics work and tracking of the samples, but in this corner here, you can, for a certain gene, you can color the brain based on more expression or low expression, red and green, across the neuroanatomy of the brain for the whole genome. And so this is kind of where it ends up. And so this study is focused on Alzheimer's disease. So as probably most of you know, it's a very devastating disorder, disease. It's the most common form of dementia. It affects 5% of those over 60. So it starts with memory impairment, and then it gets worse with confusion and behavioral change. And there's no cures. Like, there is some treatments that can slow the progression of the disorder. So it's very tragic. But it's and it also one thing that comes up the research is it's possible that there might be a preclinical or prodromal stage. So it might be that Alzheimer's disease started 20 years before you show up in the hospital with memory impairments. Or, so this is one thing to keep in mind. And so there's an, over the years, over the decades, there's been a number of hypotheses. I don't know this literature super well, but I'm just going to give you like a quick summary because it's important for the talk. So there's a cholinergic hypothesis because in the 80s, pathologists sort of discovered there was one part of the brain that had very severe degeneration. So this is parts of the brain where there's cholinergic neurons that, that deal with acetylcholinesterase. So there's anatomical support. And since then, like the drugs that have targeted the cholinergic system have been successful, but they're not very effective. So they do work, they're better than a placebo, but they're not that effective. So it can slow the progression, but yes, it doesn't reverse the progression. So and there's also one key finding is this amyloid cascade hypothesis. And the idea is, and what's observed is you see these amyloid plaques, these sort of this amyloid protein kind of bundles up and tangles up. And what happens, that basically breaks things, it's bad for neurons, and it causes neuroinflammation. So in addition to the observation of these amyloid plaques, there's also a good amount of genetic findings in genes like APOE that are involved in processing of this protein. So there's a good amount of genetic support, but the problem is many drugs that have targeted amyloid and tried to get rid of amyloid from the brain have failed in clinical trials. Currently, the best hope, I think they asked FDA for approval of one of the recent drugs that did fail, but then they looked at the data again and it seemed there was some support, so that was kind of resurrected. We'll see how that goes. Hopefully it works. And there's also a bit of a movement more away from amyloid and into tau. So this is also another protein that kind of aggregates and causes problems. This is more intracellularly, so it's sort of inside of neurons, and that sort of breaks the cytoskeletal trafficking line. So yeah, so neurofilament tangle. So and then yeah, so people are also targeting that mechanism to try and as a treatment. So that's part one. We'll see part two later. This is goes back decades, as I said. So this project is started with work. So one key thing is one way that's used to diagnose Alzheimer's disease is a brain scan. So this is a positron emission tomography, fluorodeoxyglucose positron emission tomography. So FDG PET. So it measures, basically it's telling you if how much sugar is being burned in certain parts of the brain. And you can compare that normal versus Alzheimer's cases. And what you'll see is certain parts of the brain just burn less energy. And this is useful for diagnosing if they have Alzheimer's or some other type of dementia. And this is used clinically, so it's pretty solid. That it's because it's good enough to be used in the clinic, even though it involves radioactive tracers to do this. And then you see patterns, you can see these FDG patterns in individuals that are at risk for, say, genetic risk for early onset Alzheimer's. You can see those patterns there as well before the disease is diagnosed. And so this is work by Deborah. And so actually I met Deborah, she was doing her PhD when I was doing my postdoc with Tomas Paus. And she showed this map. It was part of her PhD project. And so this is the map I'm talking about. It compares Alzheimer's cases to controls using FDG PET. And she said, like, we don't have a good idea of why these brain regions stop burning energy or you know, why these are hypometabolic parts of the brain in Alzheimer's disease. And I thought, well, this is like years ago. I was like, well, we could possibly use the Allen gene expression atlas to say what's special about these parts of the brain, like what genes are being expressed there. And so when she put it together, it was a meta-analysis. So this is not just one study of the FDG PET. This is 27 studies. So this involves hundreds of individuals that were used for this. And so what you can do is, this is kind of like an AL meta-analysis and a likelihood number that tells you, based on loading in the data from these 27 studies, how consistent is this part of the brain. So, and we set a threshold here. And so it's just basically showing, you know, what we use for data is either inside versus outside of these colored regions. So I'll talk about that more. But basically, yeah, the question is, in the owl human brain atlas, what genes have expression that match up with that pattern I just showed you? So we just keep it simple. So we're only dealing with the cortex because you don't really get much fine resolution with FDG PET down in the subcortex. We're just using non-parametric Mann-Whitney U test or Wilcoxon basically. And we did this for each brain individually just because they were done kind of years apart and they used different technologies, so they weren't all done together. And yeah, we used 15,000 genes. So we removed some genes that weren't so consistent, and that consistency measure was they actually did RNA sequencing on some samples. And so they analyzed and say these genes, they're not correlated between microarray and RNA sequencing. So they gave us like a QC pass-fail number that we used to narrow down the genes to gain some confidence in the genes we're working with. And yeah, so one question is like, why are we looking in the atlas? Why are we looking in the normal brain? Why don't you look in Alzheimer's brains? So first of all, like you can't, what's nice is the atlas is anatomically comprehensive. So you have the whole brain. And one thing is, if you look in disease brains, it might be a bit too late because neurodegeneration has gone on for so long and possibly decades. You might not see important signals. You might see just after effects. And what this might explain instead is like regional vulnerability. So this region is showing up in FDBG PET because it's not protected as well as the other brain regions. And that'd be good to know, like, how are the other parts of the brain being protected, even in the normal brain? And so this is just an image of, yes, this huge amount of degeneration in the Alzheimer's brain. So again, so here's the map. So basically, yeah, what we're doing is, this is kind of like a smooth map, so it's there's data for all of the pixels, all the voxels in the brain. But when the Allen did their gene expression, it's microarray, so they would dissect a sample here. So there'd be a bunch of spots here and there where they dissect a sample. And we asked, like, are those spots inside of the colored region or outside of the color region? So it's just inside versus out, just a binary variable. Either it's in one of these colored, either it crosses the threshold for that sample or it doesn't. And then you have 20,000 gene expression measurements, and you say for an individual gene, you compare inside versus out of these colored regions. So we kept it pretty straightforward, and we do that for the 15,000 genes. And again, we did it donor by donor. And one thing that was kind of striking to us, if you do this in the six brains, one individual, this 39-year-old male, there's 647 genes that pass multiple test correction of the 15,000. So that's a lot. In one of the donors, in the oldest individual of the six, you get 83 genes. And then the four other brains, there's no hits after multiple test correction. And if you intersect the 647 with the 83, there's only three genes that overlap, which is what you'd expect by chance. So it seems there's a unique, a strong signature in this one 39-year-old brain. So weren't too sure what to make of that. And like I said, they tried to get normal, healthy brains for this. So yeah, I forget how they word it. Like, I think it was, yeah. So anyways, they tried their best to get normal brains. And so for this particular individual, like I said, 39-year-old male, and this person, it was the shortest postmortem interval. So postmortem interval is like when they passed away to when the brain was dissected and frozen and handled. So was it, you know, how quickly was the tissue captured? Also, this individual, which is linked to that other point, is had the highest RNA quality as measured by the RIN number. And the interesting thing is of the six brains, they noted, the Allen Institute noted, and a pathologist went through to check if these are normal brains, they noted that this individual had a single neurofibrillary tangle in the entorhinal cortex. So these tangles are linked to tau and Alzheimer's disease, especially in this part of the brain. So the entorhinal cortex is close to the hippocampus. It's related to memory. So this, but it is, it's just one. So it, you know, it might be nothing. And another interesting point, again, which might be coincidental, I'll talk about it more, is lidocaine and its metabolite was detected in the blood of this individual, but not any of the other five individuals. So it's like, it's a single case, but still it's, I'm gonna go through, so now we have this individual. So one question is like, what are these genes? So these 600 genes. So we have a bunch of number one hits, which I like and are kind of convincing. It's one way to like filter things down. So I'm going to go through those one by one. So the first one, this is the top gene. So this is the gene most differentially expressed in that one individual, in that one brain from the 39-year-old. And so, you know, there'll be other genes that will be differentially expressed, and at least that oldest individual. And so this is the signal from that specific brain, so 121. So maybe what I'll just refer to it as. So, and you can see clearly in the others, there's no, and this kind of gives you a feel of how many samples are inside and out. So basically these are, all these dots is a sample from inside of those hypometabolic regions. And then all the rest are basically outside. So it gives you a feel, it's like 7-10%, I forget exactly, but this individual is not unique in the number that are inside versus out of those regions in that map with the red and orange coloring. So that's the top hit. So this gene, number one gene of 15,000, and it's a ribosomal protein for the large subunit. And so it might seem like a boring gene, which is fine, you know. But one thing we noticed is this, the top gene ontology group, so you do gene ontology analysis, the top gene ontology group contains this gene, and the top gene ontology group is visualized here. So now each dot, each dot is actually a gene. And so down here, these are the genes that are underexpressed in the hypometabolic region. So you can maybe say these are like protective genes. They're protecting the rest of the brain. That's why you don't see a change in energy usage. And then up here is the genes that are most overexpressed in the regions of reduced hypometabolism in the Alzheimer's brain. So what you see is this GO group, it's way up on top. So the black bar is the average for all those. I think it's about 87 genes here. So this black bar is just showing you the median, I think. And these lighter gray bars is just across the whole genome, because this is the whole 15,000, and we're just marking the genes in this GO group. So what you see is most of the time this is in the middle for the five, but in that one individual, there's a lot of genes that are down-regulated. So there's a lot of genes that are underexpressed in the regions of hypometabolism. So there's less energy bearing, there's also less mRNA there. There's less transcription, it seems. But still, these genes definitely stick out on top. And then, so you see RPL34, the top gene, is in the top gene ontology group, and it's marked there on the top, just so you understand what's going on with this figure. And so the GO group's marked on the side. I guess it's a bit hard to read, but it's basically up top here. So this is a bit of a mouthful. It's SRP, which is signal recognition particle dependent co-translational protein targeting to the membrane. And the synonym is a lot shorter, but it's not as specific, so ER translocation. So this is, there's a signal, and that signal brings the ribosome to the endoplasmic reticulum, and then whatever that ribosome is translating, it translates it into the endoplasmic reticulum. So that's basically what you get in the definition there. So two components, so the SRP particle connects with the receptor, and it binds to the ER. So that's basically it. So, but what if you look inside this gene ontology group, like the first gene, it's mostly ribosomal proteins. It's not 100%, but it's not mitochondrial ribosome proteins. It's not the, but it's cytosolic ribosomal proteins. So again, that might be boring. One question we had is, do these genes have any connection to Alzheimer's disease? So we wondered. Actually, we had this top GO group come up a long time, years ago. Some undergraduate students working on it, Alana and Joelle, and they found this GO group, and I looked it up, and I didn't see any connection to Alzheimer's disease. You know, they did their undergraduate report, and they did really good on the project, and actually, it comes up on top when you do all six of the brains together, which they did at the time, and later, I went back and did each brain individually to see that it was just one brain driving it. Yeah, so I didn't really see any connection for a while until one of my colleagues, Dan Felsky, presented a paper. And actually, first, I'll go over this. So first, there is some connection. So ribosomes are connected to Alzheimer's disease. It's not a big hypothesis like the others, but there is some papers. Some say ribosome dysfunction is an early event. Also tau, I mentioned the tau hypothesis. Tau does co-localize with ribosomes, and there's more details on that. So there's some support there in the literature. But yeah, so this kind of Alzheimer's hypotheses part two, so these are newer ones. And one thing that have been observed for a while is inflammation, so chronic inflammation in the brain, and there's active microglia. So microglia are the brain's macrophages, so they're like immune cells in the brain that handle getting rid of things that shouldn't be there. But one key thing about the inflammation thing is anti-inflammatory drugs do not work for Alzheimer's disease so far. But yeah, so, but more recently there's been an antimicrobial protection hypothesis, and it could be that the amyloid and the tau are responses to a pathogen. And one thing is that these plaques and tangles are sticky. So the idea is there is that they could capture these pathogens and prevent them from spreading. And there are some papers showing that there is antimicrobial properties of amyloid. And it's also good to keep in mind that amyloid is well conserved across species. So it seems important, basically. And more recently is the ginger pain hypothesis. And this is, I guess, it's tied to the above. These are all interrelated and also interrelated with part one of the hypotheses, because I'm mentioning amyloid here. But this proposes that a specific bacteria, P. gingivalis, causes Alzheimer's disease. And there's a specific part of this. It seems this bacteria is really mean, it seems. So it secretes proteases, actually secretes also these things called microbullets, which are like small vesicles packed with bad things that it sheds. But yeah, so in addition to secreting proteases, it eats amino acids for energy. So it ferments amino acids, that's its energy source. So, and it is a keystone pathogen in periodontal disease, so in the mouth. So it's known to cause disease there. And so it's currently, there's vaccines in progress. People are working on that. There's also this Domini et al. Is working on an inhibitor and testing that out in trials. So for Alzheimer's. So we'll see how that goes. So this, I probably wrote the most for this one because that's the one that Dan Fauske introduced me, that my colleague introduced me this time. So like I said before, I had this ribosomal goal group and I didn't think much of it at the time. And then I actually ended up Googled this GO group and periodontal disease and gingivalis just to see, is there any connection to this new hypothesis? Is there any link there? And it turns out there is. I found this paper, and that's the same GO group, SRP, co-translational protein target. And this, so genes in that GO group are upregulated in parts of the gingival tissue that are inflamed, that are infected with P. gingivalis and a bunch of other pathogens that go with it. So that was interesting. I was surprised. And the key thing is it's number one as well. And so it's not specifically gingivalis, it's periodontal disease, but I also found another study of peri-implant soft tissue. So again, it's in the mouth. And again, it shows up number one, SRP-dependent co-translational protein targeting to membrane, the same set of genes. So, you know, that could be chance. And again, these studies are not super big studies. This is actually a master's thesis, which I don't think has been published as far as I can tell. But still, I find it informative. And it sort of started us out on this path of looking more into these genes. And so, yeah, one question is this just like a non-specific GO group? It just shows up wherever. It's kind of like, it gets around maybe. So it's not, so it's, we grabbed data from some friends of mine and they did a differential expression meta-analysis. And we can go in there and say like, does this GO group show up in 635 differential expression studies across a bunch of conditions like cancer, some of it brain, a whole mix. And yeah, you don't see it number one in any of those 635. So that's informative. They also give you a number that says, what's the chance that this gene will be differentially expressed in any condition? And these ribosomal genes, these cytosolic ribosomal genes, or ER translocation genes, are not, they have low prior probability of being differentially expressed. So the median is 0.24 between 0 and 1. So that's good to know. reassuring, so there might be something there. And again, yeah, that's their paper there. And so one thing to keep in mind, and there's a lot more of this literature, but 10 years of chronic periodontal disease is a risk factor for Alzheimer's. And also the DNA has been detected, P. gingivalis DNA has been detected in brain and cerebrospinal fluid. And also gingipane's reactivity has shown up too. So this is in the Dominique paper in Science Advances, and there's also other studies as well. So there's also mouse models that infect the mice with gingivalis, and then they look in the brain, and there's some support there as well. And so, but one thing about this bacteria is these genes might make sense in terms of mechanism. So this is a figure from a review in 2006, and this is an epithelial cell, so like in the mouth or endothelial. I'm not sure, but yeah, endothelial cells. And so this is kind of like how it gets in and what it does. And so these little red blobs are the bacteria. And so once it gets in, there's these green arrows with the question mark on it. So I didn't put those there. That's actually in their figure. And I'm like, okay. Because one way to do that, to follow to traffic to the endoplasmic reticulum, is by you could hitch a ride maybe on a ribosome that's going there. And so like, yeah, so it's like pretty fast too, they say. I think these are like rapidly traffics to the ER, this bacteria, once it gets in the cell. So that was kind of nice to see. It might make sense, it kind of makes sense in terms of mechanism for the name of this go group and what's going on here. So, and there's other things going on here. So here's like it goes to the ER, let's use the pointer, it goes to the ER, and then it kind of surrounds itself. And it uses the ER membrane to protect itself, basically. And yeah, it's a bit, and then, but usually, and these vesicles look a lot like autophagosomes, but they don't end up joining up with the lysosomes and everything doesn't get destroyed. It somehow bypasses the step where it doesn't join up with the lysosome and it just proliferates in these autophagosome-like vacuoles. So one thing, I made one edit to this because there is a paper in 2001, and actually a share author, that says there's undegraded ribosomes inside of these vacuoles that also contain P. gingivalis. So that's also informative. It might be a good food source for them because they like eating amino acids. And yeah, so that was cool. It was helpful to understand what might be going on, but again, it's speculative. If this actually happens in the brain, don't know. But given this link to infection, one question is like, what's going on with the microglia? So these are like the brain's resident macrophages that clean things up. And so we took a look at that. One way to do this is look at just what happens to the microglia marker. So these are genes that are specifically expressed, just like the previous talk. These are markers. And you can see, if you look at, say, like the bottom, so these are genes that are kind of like turned off in the hypometabolic regions in that map way back when. And they're kind of, the marker genes are expressed, in the five brains. So again, these are the donor brains. And what you see is, they're kind of, microglia marker genes are low expression. Whereas in this, the individual, the 39-year-old, the 121, it's higher for sure. And you can sort of look across here and see the figure, but if you look at this statistically in this table, there's a lot of numbers here. The key thing is the AUC for the five brains for these microglia marker genes is like 0.11. So that means they're not expressed highly in those regions that are lighting up in the map. And that switches to 0.62 in that one individual. So that's like another number one hit, you could say, but I'm only testing six cell types here. Six cell types. So another way, a more sophisticated way you could do this, which would make more sense, is you can use tools that estimate the proportion of the cells, estimate the proportion of neurons and microglia, given the whole transcriptomic data set and some markers. We also see that signal when we do it that way. So we see an interaction. So in the hypometabolic regions, in this donor, there's a lower estimated proportion of microglia than there's a higher estimated proportion of microglia than you'd expect by chance So it seems microglia turn on, or at least you see more activity based on this data. So yeah, so one question also we had is, and it's one that when I talk about allelesis, it's one of the things we do often is just saying, where are these genes being used in the brain? So when we did this first stage analysis, we just focused on the cortex. But there's a lot more data in the subcortex, a lot more interesting parts of the brain that we're kind of ignoring so far. So we used the same Allen6 brain data set and just asked, where are these ER translocation genes being used in the brain? And so the number one hit of across like 232 brain regions is substantia in nominata, so the unnamed substance. So this is a part of the brain. A key thing about this part of the brain is there's a lot of cholinergic neurons. And so when they originally put together the cholinergic hypothesis, this is the part of the brain that drove that hypothesis because they saw massive degeneration in this part of the brain in cholinergic neurons. So that's super interesting. We're a bit surprised, like we don't. And again, this is across 236 brain regions, which you'll sort of see. Here's a way of showing it on a figure. It's a bit tricky with this brain, So again, there's six panels because there's six individuals. And now each dot is a brain region that they annotated with the name. So there's 3,700 samples, but there's many samples for some parts of the brain. So it boils down to 232 brain regions. And we marked the red dots for substantia in nominata. But they only had that in the first two brains. So this is the 121 and the 9861. But here in the other four brains, they actually did a finer dissection of that part of the brain. And these red dots are regions that are inside of the substantia in nominata. And so you don't see a clear pattern so much in these four, but definitely substantia in nominata shows up on top. And when you combine all the data across these two, so we combine all six brains, the top brain region is substantia in nominata. And so that links to cholinergic stuff, but this is bulk tissue. Again, so there's lots of cell types here. So one question is, and you've heard about single cell data sets, are these genes expressed in cholinergic neurons? So we go to an atlas, a single cell atlas from the Linerson lab, Ziesel et al. And we can look up, just say, you know, are these genes being expressed specifically in cholinergic neurons? And the answer is yes. So there's, in this data set, there's 265 cell types they found. It was a pretty big data set. It was like 500,000 cells originally going into it. And across those 265, I don't know if I'd say cell types, but more accurately be transcriptomic cell clusters or cell groups, but it is a cholinergic enteric neuron. So these are cholinergic neurons, but enteric means they're in the gut. So this study, it wasn't just the brain, it was the whole nervous system of the mouse or central nervous system, I forget exactly. So yeah, peripheral nervous system as well. So that's why we see cholinergic. There is some studies that find less cholinergic neurons in the gut of Alzheimer's disease. I think it was a mouse model. In a mouse model of Alzheimer's disease, there was differences observed in cholinergic enteric neurons. So that gives a little bit of support here as well. This is just a rough visualization we also put together here. Yeah, so I didn't explain the other one as well, variable nine, I think. But so this axis here on the x-axis is just a cholinergic gene. So in addition to it being cholinergic in the name, that helps you figure out if it's cholinergic neuron, you can look at a choline O transferase, acetyl transferase, to get a feel for using the gene expression data. So that kind of agrees with the naming. Most of the ones that are named cholinergic are on this side. And then on the y-axis is the SRP, the ER translocation genes. That's just asking, are they specifically expressed in that cell type versus the other cell type? So not exactly a marker, but is there just higher expression? So you see a range. And then every one of those dots is a transcriptomic cell type. So every one of those dots is a maybe 200 or maybe 1,000, maybe 10,000 cells. And I'm just looking at the average expression of these genes. And you see these genes are expressed at higher levels in the cholinergic enteric neurons. And then also you see a telencephalon up here as well. So you also see it in cholinergic neurons in the brain in this data set. And actually, all of them are above 0.5 on the AUC. So 0.5 on the AUC is just random chance, and they're all on the higher end, on the overexpression of that SRP gene. So that was nice. And so, yeah, one key point is all the preceding gene expression analysis was in a normal data. So that mouse atlas of cells is normal mice. And yeah, the six brains are, well, as normal as they can find. And so one question is, are these SRP genes differentially expressed in the Alzheimer's brain? And so the data is not, you don't get comprehensive, you get the whole genome, but you don't get comprehensive in terms of parts of the brain. So there's a bit of a trade-off there, but we can still ask these questions. And so here's a study that helped us ask this question. And this study is it's in mice, but it's an Alzheimer's model. So they took human Alzheimer's genes with human mutations, two genes and five mutations, and they put that in the mice genome. And then these mice develop Alzheimer's-like symptoms. So it's a mouse model for Alzheimer's disease. And what they did is they compared the brains of these mice to, you know, normal control brains, but they only looked at microglia. So they did, they fact-sorted out the microglia cells, these resident immune cells, and then they did a single-cell gene expression of those microglia. And what you see is they noticed something in particular. So they have microglia 1, 2, 3, and that's these colors, and you see there's a whole bunch of microglia, this nice sphere in the T-SNE plot. And you could probably think of it as like, they call these like homeostatic, they probably call them like normal microglia. And then they started to see this little like, you know, spot sticking out here, and you have this orange and red. And they found these are disease-associated microglia by looking at, say, these are co-localized with amyloid, for example. And this shows up in the mouse model of Alzheimer's disease, but not the normal mice. So now you have sort of a transcriptomic profile of what Alzheimer's disease-associated microglia in mice look like. So the question is, like, what happens to the SRP genes in these microglia? And, you know, this is motivated by the microglia findings we have previously. That helps that we're all still in microglia. And then we just asked, it's a simple question, is do the SRP genes, like, step up as it goes? So do the SRP genes step up in expression as it goes from yellow to orange to red? And if you look at all the tested genes in the universe of genes, it's 6.4 chance. So the chance of that double step jumping up is 6.4. For the SRP genes, it's 75% of the SRP genes step up across this. So it's a bit surprising. And if you compare that to all the other Go groups, it's another number one hit, which is nice. So none of the Go groups beat that out. And so here's how it looks just visually. So it's a bit skinny, but basically you can see all the ribosomal genes, and you can see blue is low expression, and it steps up. So the labels at the bottom is kind of normal homeostatic microglia. The next step is like group 2 disease-associated microglia, and then finally step 3 is that red cluster in the T-SNE plot is the most disease-associated microglia there. And what was interesting, they found that if you kind of block these microglia from forming, things get worse. So it seems like these activated disease-associated microglia are slowing down Alzheimer's disease. Okay, so this is not totally linked to gingivalis or the cholinergic hypothesis, but one thing to note is the number one gene, the number one hit is CST7, so this is crystalline F, and this gene actually blocks cystine proteases. And gingipain is, I mentioned a protease, it is a cystine protease as well. So that's interesting. So beyond this mouse model, what about actual Alzheimer's cases? So we found a recent data set, and they did not a single cell study, a single nucleus study of single cells, and it was in the prefrontal cortex, and 48 individuals. And again, they did many cell types, so we just restricted to microglia, again, given the previous findings. And what we found is, again, the SRP targeting genes, you can do, the way they had their analysis set up, they compared normal individuals with early pathology, and then they did another pairwise comparison of early pathology with late pathology, where things are getting worse. And so across these two pairwise jumps, you definitely see that the SRP ER translocation genes step up in these two pairwise comparisons. And so in addition to doing that, so this is how it looks in RSC curve. And so basically these black lines mark the genes that are overexpressed in pathology. I'm just showing, and they're the ER translocation genes. So that's another way of visualizing it. Another way of visualizing it, just like before, is just say, combine these two stepwise comparisons they did, binary comparisons, and just say, do you see a stepwise jump from no to early to late pathology for these genes? And you do, so a triple. So of the 7,300 genes, it's about 17%, 18%, and that triples to 55% for this gene ontology group. And you can say, what about other gene ontology groups? So unfortunately, it's not the number one anymore. It's the second ranked. But yeah, it's still strong because we're, I didn't mention before, we're testing like 6,000 Go groups here. So it's a lot. And then here's the visualization. So as you can see, blue to red. So it split the mouse you've seen before, but the human is right here. And so the summary of the top one hits. So ribosome protein, we see the SRP, it enriched in this one donor. And it also shows up number one in two studies of periodontal disease. Of the six cell types, microglia is number one. And we have connections to cholinergic, substantia, and ulnar, because those are number one in terms of brain regions, number one in terms of transcriptomic cell types. And yeah, we see a progressive increase in microglia as well, at least in the mice, is number one. So that's number one. And number two, we do see at number two, in the human data set. So the number one in both these cases is cytosol ribosomal gene ontology group. So it's like a difference of two or three genes between those two Go groups. So it's sort of pretty close in terms of first, second place. One thing I didn't notice, but there is RNA sequencing data for two of the six brains. And if you do the same analysis, this Go group and the RNA sequencing data will be ranked second in the same direction. So that's reassuring. So just a quick summary of the connections to the gingivalis, to the gingivalin hypothesis. As you see this Go group, you also see some other Go groups, which are not number one hits, I'm going to go over it, but you also see more microglia, which suggests possibly some inflammation. I mentioned the lidocaine. So lidocaine is a commonly used dental anesthetic. It's also used in other situations as well. This might just be a coincidence, but it helped spur our research on. Keep looking, and then yeah, I mentioned this the CST7 already. And so the cholinergic hypothesis, yeah, we have brain regions that have a lot of cholinergic neurons. We see it in the cholinergic cell types. And one key thing to note is these neurons might have maybe higher demands on the ER translocation mechanism because the acetylcholine esterases are processed in the ER. So it might have a lot more ER activity than your average neuron. And yeah, we also mentioned that there was a tangle in this brain. So, and so one, as bioinformaticians, is kind of like for the bioinformaticians is, I mentioned the bills already, but one thing, and you, if you ever guys have ever done any co-expression, ribosomal proteins are kind of like, are highly co-expressed. So they all move together. So if these genes move, they move in concert, which can explain some of our, why it shows up number one. But in terms of multifunctionality, these genes are average amount of multifunctionality, and I mentioned the differential expression already, so they don't really show up as being differentially expressed. And so, yeah, the conclusions is we highlighted this individual who might have been on the way to Alzheimer's disease, we don't know. And we connected the genes from that finding to two hypotheses of Alzheimer's disease, one more recent and one going back decades ago. And so it's possible the vulnerability across the brain might be related to cytosolic ribosomes and their trafficking to the endoplasmic reticulum. Not sure. But yeah, and it suggests a closer connection between these two hypotheses. And yeah, and we see things clearly in microglia. And so, yeah, acknowledgements. Sajal and Derek, who are in the audience, and I show their pictures, so if you want to seek them out and ask more specific questions. Also, Alana and Joelle, they did more of the earlier work as undergraduates. And then Daniel, also for helping me connect up with the microglia work and pointing out this new hypothesis. And Deborah did the meta-analysis of the FDG PET studies, which was huge, a huge task. And also Zdenka and Tomas worked with her to do that, and they've worked with me throughout my postdoc too. And yeah, thank you to the funders as well. And yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you.